vanoggend se onderwerp is dan nou rakende COVID-19. So ek gaan vir professor François Venter van Wits verwelkom en hy kuier vanoggend saam om te gesels oor of Suid-Afrika 'n tweede inperking en COVID-19 golf kan oorleef. So good morning Professor Venter and thank you so much for joining us.
How's everybody?
I would like to start with some background on yourself, as well as background regarding Essentia and the fact that you are involved within that regard. What exactly does that entail?
So we're a research and policy unit at WITS. We've mainly been involved in HIV, and we've brought a whole of those skills across the COVID world. Until February, there were no experts on this coronavirus. We've all had to learn on the fly. And I think a lot of the skills we have with HIV, which is its own pandemic, we've been able to apply to COVID.
And your background specifically?
Mine's very firmly in the HIV world. Firstly, you know, advocating for public health programs for better and safer drugs, for you know, access to better treatment for HIV. So HIVs and TB are our own pandemics. In fact, South Africa has lots of pandemics. You know, those were the two biggies. But listeria, which everyone will remember from 2 or 3 years ago, the polony-like infection. But we've also exported our expertise just across the border in terms of our malaria expertise. We've had cholera expertise. But we also sent all of our doctors and our experts across to the Ebola epidemics. That have, you know, since the 60s, we've had people going there to help out.
What is your opinion regarding the possibility of a second wave in terms of COVID-19 in Gauteng and our country overall?
So I think it's speculative, and I think it's very important. I know it's very frustrating for the public to hear all the scientists saying, I'm not sure, but it really is the case that we're not sure. What we've seen in South Africa almost certainly is a massive, massive first wave. So there's some speculation as much as 40% of the population got infected in the first wave. It also happened much earlier than we predicted. We thought it was going to happen in September, but it seems to have happened in June and July. So that first wave was much worse than what we saw in Asia or in Europe. So Europe, across Europe, they're experiencing the second wave, but in the context where only a small minority of their people were infected. So we're kind of hoping that our second wave is going to be blunted, or that it's going to be more like a slow burn, which is what we're sort of seeing at the moment, where there's a steady influx of cases. We're probably down to 5 or 10% of where we were at our peak, but there's still a steady number of cases coming through the door. But there is the possibility that we'll have a second wave that is like the 6 months later, which is what they're seeing in Europe.
Do we have the capacity to handle a possible second wave as a country?
So we handled the first wave. So if I'm right, and most people seem to think this is what's happening, that the first wave was the worst. We managed to get through the first wave. You know, the hospitals were not overwhelmed, other than a few cases in a couple of areas in the Gauteng, Western Cape, actually coped okay, and Durban, the big urban areas. So my instinct is that we'll be okay for a second wave. I think the thing that's not okay is that I think people seem to think this thing is just a flu, you know, still, and it really is not. This thing kills old people and diabetics and hypertensives and people on chemotherapy. So it's not like we can take our eye off the ball. We still need to protect those people. And for those people, it's a scary situation where, you know, we've had a couple of months of severe lockdown, but you still can't come out from behind your closed doors because this virus is still circulating and is trying to find those fault lines. And what we're seeing in some countries is that places which weren't affected initially are getting infected with the second wave. So it's very frustrating at the moment that until we have a vaccine, people just are not safe who are vulnerable to the after effects of the virus.
I would like to refer to a recent report, and I'm going to read a part of it. According to the medical expert, Professor Salim Abdul Karim, he said that if a second wave of infections hit South Africa in the same way it has hit European nations, tighter lockdown restrictions will be back, but this time it will be on a local level. He also said that the government is currently setting up task teams to handle this type of lockdown should it become necessary. So this would finally see the implementation of the district model of lockdown that was announced by the health department in May 2020, earlier this year, when the virus was still building its presence in the country. And I think, they also refer to 52 different districts. Do you think that is, that would be effective?
It's what we should have been doing right from the start. It made absolutely no sense. Yeah, there were chunks. There are 52 districts in South Africa. It didn't make sense, for instance, in the rural areas to have total lockdowns when there were no cases. I have friends of mine in the rural hospitals who say they've seen a handful of cases over the last 6 months. We didn't need to lock down those areas. So a more intelligent way of dealing. I'm not a big fan of lockdown language. I think that it's a very crude instrument. I think we should be rather discussing how do we protect old people, how do we protect people with comorbidities and things like that. Mm-hmm. So, for instance, this local travel ban of international travelers coming into South Africa, it doesn't make any sense whatsoever. It makes much more sense to quarantine people to have travel bans from Joburg to Nelspruit than it is to have it them from London to Johannesburg.
I'm just going to stop you there for a moment. I'm so sorry for interrupting you, but we will continue with this discussion right after the news. Nuus so pas in, Netwerk 24 berig dat president Donald Trump, asook sy vrou Melania, positief getoets het vir die coronavirus. Ek dog net ek deel dit gou, maar ons gaan voort met vanoggend se gesprek en weer eens wil ek jou aandag vestig op die feit dat ons nie sê dat daar definitief 'n tweede vlaag van COVID-19 in Gauteng of in die land gaan wees nie. Dis volgens wetenskaplike navorsing, so dit is wat die kenners sê en dit is wat daar berig word en dit is hoekom ons vanoggend hierdie gesprek voer net na aanleiding van die boodskappe wat ons ontvang.
En die feit dat mense ook kyk na internasionale nuus, soos wat ons sopas ontvang het ook.
Presies. So ons gaan dan nou voort met vanoggend se gesprek en dit met professor Francha Venter van Wits Universiteit. Thanks again for joining us this morning, Professor Venter. And I would like to continue with our discussion earlier, about the local travel ban, amongst other things that just don't make sense at this stage.
Yeah, I think it's one of the critiques I have of government's approach to this pandemic is not explaining its decisions. And sometimes it's not a purely medical decision. You know, sometimes you have to take economic things into account, other factors. I really wish they would just explain their thinking. The international travel ban makes absolutely no sense. You know, we have an epidemic that's still continuing inside the country. I've said several times it makes more sense to ban Johannesburg people going to Nelspruit than it makes for banning people from London coming to Johannesburg. I really don't get it. It's almost legislation and rules for the sake of making them. It's not protecting anyone. It's not going to significantly add to the burden of disease within the country. A whole of the other stuff around it about, you know, insisting on insurance and everything. You know, I don't understand why all of that's in place either. If there are countries throughout the world that insist that you have medical insurance before you travel to them. But that's for all diseases. I don't understand why the coronavirus gets special treatment in terms of this. So, yeah, I'm quite disappointed in this response from government. I think the tourism industry has been decimated. It needs all the help it can get. And I don't understand why they're differentiating between business and non-business travelers. You know, they're equally likely to have the virus, equally likely to spread, if that's your concern. Mm-hmm. So none of it makes sense to me.
I would also like to refer to the role and also the importance of research within this regard.
So South Africa's, I'm quite proud of the researchers in terms of the South African capacity, particularly the vaccine people. They were able to, you know, South Africa has some of the best vaccine researchers in the world, and they were able to pivot almost immediately and take the very first candidates and say, we're ready. We're battle ready to put this into the populations. And they got stuck in immediately and started recruiting. So that has been really impressive. Other researchers have looked at treatment options for both prevention and treatment of COVID. So yeah, you know, we're learning on the fly. We know a hang of a lot more than we knew 6 months ago, but still there's plenty to know about this disease. The one thing I think that has been quite surprising is it doesn't behave like the flu virus. You know, flu often knocks out your immune system and then you get a pneumonia, a bacterial superinfection, and that's what makes you so sick. The flu itself makes you pretty sick, but it's the bacterial thing that kills you. Well, with COVID, it's COVID that actually does the damage. You know, in most cases, it seems to really knock you back on your, you know, quite severely. And we keep talking about people recovered. You know, a lot of people seem to have a lot of symptoms of COVID once they've recovered, or so-called recovered. You know, they're often very tired. They have long-term headaches. They really feel down.
And then, you know, when you're taking a look at the fact that we got this warning now from the Department of Health, and, you know, I'm sure there's a lot of people who don't agree and they don't want to believe it, like we've also said earlier in this interview. But is it important to, you know, rather know about this to act in a preventative way? Mm. What would you say?
Absolutely. I mean, you heard Donald Trump's now got it. Uh-huh. You know, everyone's tired of the virus. Everyone's tired of lockdown. The virus is not tired. It's looking for every fault it can find. It'll find its way through the fault lines in society, where the channels are. And I think what we have learned over the last 6 months is the physical distancing is by far and away the most important thing. And if you can do it outdoors, it makes you so, so, so much more safe. And the masks are very good, and they certainly give you extra time. So if you would have caught it in 10 minutes, you'll catch it in 15 minutes if you're wearing a mask, and you won't transmit it as easily if you do have it. So I think between, you know, the surfaces, we've realized there may still be a room for it to transmit. So washing your hands and wiping down surfaces probably makes some sense, but the real way you're going to catch it is, you know, is being in close contact. And this is why many of us in the scientific community in South Africa are very worried about diluting the message about lockdown. We really think that people need whether it's lockdown 5 or lockdown 1, people should not be in close quarters with each other. Mm-hmm. And this is why music events, church events, you know, weddings indoors, those things, anything you can move outdoors makes you exponentially safer. And we should not be doing stuff indoors unless it's very brief and it's absolutely, absolutely necessary.
How would you describe the role of the World Health Organization within this regard? And why is it so important to learn from other countries?
So the World Health Organization, I'm a huge fan in general because we've really leant on them for our HIV response, and they've done amazing work there. I haven't been particularly impressed with the role that they've played in certainly for Africa and South Africa. They focused too much on the testing. Their advice on schools was incoherent and actually confused people in a situation where we needed that advice. So I haven't been thrilled about WHO. In terms of other countries, it's really important for us to keep an eye on it, but also to be careful about overlooking it. You know, in Asia, particularly in places like China, they've had like an iron fist approach to things. In South Korea, they've had all these apps on people's phones that they've been able to use to monitor and to contact trace. You know, we've got this app, but we haven't used it as quickly and as efficiently as the South Koreans. While in Europe, you know, people are able to physically distance themselves at home much more efficiently than, say, for instance, in the informal settlements in South Africa. So there are lessons, but we need to be quite careful about how South Africa is different. I think we're much more like like Brazil and some of the poorer Asian countries where people are living in slums around the urban areas. And that's where the virus seems to be tearing its way through.
But so in essence, you are not worried. You do think that our government has the capacity to handle this effectively.
I've been very disappointed in the South African government, to be quite honest. Okay. I think that the handling of it has been marked more by lots and lots of laws and legislation and lockdown laws, rather than focusing on the basics, which is supporting the physical distancing, the masks, to support societies and to think of creative ways to protect the vulnerable. We shouldn't have been having a lot of these discussions. I'm not interested anymore in lockdown 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. I'm much more interested in how are we going to encourage the physical distancing at every until we have a vaccine. And this is a couple of years project. You know, I don't see a situation where it's going to be safe to go to church, to go to an indoor wedding, to go to anywhere which is indoors with more than a couple of people. What we should be doing is trying to encourage outdoors as much as possible. Restaurants, you know, let's try and get those windows open, get the doors open, try and talk to the gyms about what is adequate ventilation so that the society can open up as safely as it can. It's never going to be 100% safe, but to make it as safe as it can and have the kind of policy and discussions around that. Stop trying to micromanage every tiny facet of the epidemic through the law. Yes. Try and get the society to rebuy.
Thank you so much for your time. That was dan Professor François Venter van Wits.